introduce our speaker for tonight. I did just have a couple quick and Paula Morgan come speak. She is a graduate of our program. And again, she and I were LinkedIn connections. I saw the great stuff she was doing. I reached out to her and asked if she would be willing to speak, and she is here. We have had students who are interested in the public health service. So I thought that this would be a great opportunity to learn more about that. And in my role in the Coast Guard, I've worked with people who have been stationed with public health service and also Indian Health Service. And they do some amazing stuff that I really wanted to learn more about. So I was very excited that she was able to come talk to us. So before I read her intro, I just wanted to, she's going to go through her PowerPoint. If you've got questions for her, please, she'll welcome questions throughout the presentation. You don't have to wait until the end. Just either raise your hand or type them in the chat, and I'll be watching both of those for her. So Lieutenant Morgan attended Washington and Jefferson College in Washington, Pennsylvania, and received her bachelor's in environmental studies. She also did her degree in public health preparedness with us, and she graduated in 2015. And then she got a master of public health in environmental health from Westchester University of Pennsylvania in 2018. So she's certified in public health, associate safety professional, and registered environmental health specialist, registered sanitarian. She began her environmental health career as an environmental health and safety consultant in Pennsylvania, and she was doing audits of various industrial and healthcare facilities. Since May of 2021, she's served as the, she's been a EHSEHO with the Indian Health Service, and she's been working with tribes throughout Utah and the Reno District. So again, Paula, thank you so much for coming and speaking tonight, and I will turn it over to you.
All right, thank you. As you mentioned, my name is Paula. I'm an environmental health officer for the Indian Health Service Commission Corps. Tonight, we're just going to go over a quick overview of the public health service and then the Indian Health Service and how they both relate to public health. So as she read my background, I'm a newly commissioned environmental health officer. I've been in the Commission Corps for about 4 months. I'm based out of Fort Duchesne, Utah. This is where I'm stationed. I fall in the Reno District Office of Environmental Health and Engineering, or OEHE, which resides in the greater Phoenix area for the Indian Health Service. And my primary job and function is anything related to environmental health and safety for the tribes of Utah, including Northern and Southern Utah. First, we're gonna go over the Commission Corps Public Health Service. So the United States Public Health Service Commission Corps is one of the nation's eight uniformed services. This is the branch that's committed to the service of health for the United States. There are over 6,000 well-trained Commission Corps officers over various degrees in public health. We serve in almost over 800 locations in the U.S. and around the world, depending on what agency you work for. And we serve as a large component of the public health and response program in the United States and throughout the world. So the mission of the Commission Corps is to protect, promote, and advance the health and safety of our nation. And then we have the four main core values listed on here: leadership, integrity, service, and excellence, all surrounding and around public health and our commitment to the underserved and underpopulated areas. So we mentioned there's eight uniformed service branches. Most people are familiar with the branches under the Department of Defense or the DOD. This is your Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, and now the Space Force. The Commission Corps falls under the Department of Health of Human Services. That is our uniformed service branch. And as people mentioned, the Coast Guard falls under the Department of Homeland Security, and there's also the NOAA Corps, which falls under the Department of Commerce. Commission Corps officers do serve in the Coast Guard and NOAA. And depending on where you're located, you may work closely with Department of Defense employees also. And this is a breakdown of our current leadership. Currently, Admiral Levine is our Assistant Secretary for Health. She also serves as the head of the Public Health Service. She is the primary advisor on matters involving the nation's public health, including policy direction. And then we have the Surgeon General, Vice Admiral Murphy. He serves as the nation's doctor, if you've heard of the Surgeon General. His goal is to restore trust by relying on the best scientific available information to provide to the public, and provide clear, consistent guidance and resources to the public on current topics today, as you can see with COVID going on. Then we have Rear Admiral Hinton, who's a Deputy Surgeon General. She provides support and advises the Surgeon General and also provides support for the Public Health Service in communicating, again, that best available authentic information to advance the health of the nation. And then we have the Chief of Staff, Max Lesko, in addition to our Chief Professional Officers. So in the Public Health Service, there are 11 categories spanning different professions. Each profession has a Chief Professional Officer or CPO. These individuals provide leadership and coordination for each of your categories, and they're very influential on matters such as recruitment, retention, career development as you as an officer, and they also facilitate the professional and community relationships with the Surgeon General and the community that we serve and those initiatives that are going on during this time period. So as I mentioned, I'm an environmental health officer. I fall under the environmental health professional category. There are 11, ranging from physicians to a kind of catch-all, the health services officer, which has your allied health, public health education, and health information management. So if you have a degree in one of these categories and you have an interest, the link that I put into the chat box kind of breaks down the requirements for each of these categories, job tasks you might be doing, agencies you might be able to work at. It is pretty broad and it's pretty various paths depending on what you're looking for to advance your public health career. As we mentioned, the Public Health Service is considered America's health responders. They provide essential healthcare services to underserved and vulnerable populations. They deploy for public health emergencies, as we saw with COVID. It also relates to natural disasters and humanitarian assistance. And then we also have the leading the public health programs and policy development with the Department of Health and Human Services and throughout the federal government, as you might see with the CDC, FDA, Commissioned Corps officers work in all those areas and have a great influence in research and policy. And then there's also advancing the innovation in science for the most challenging issues. As COVID has shown, it's constantly changing. There's always a need for more additional research and backgrounds. They also did a lot with the science of Ebola, cancer, food safety, mental health, and more. As you mentioned, they deploy humanitarian missions, pandemics. This is kind of a general list of things that public health officers have deployed to within the last 20 years. So you can see hurricanes, tropical storms, Ebola, anthrax, the unaccompanied children at the border, severe weather, and even contamination and chemical exposures. You might see Commissioned Corps officers. The Commissioned Corps was originally created to protect the health of sailors and immigrants in the late 1700s. This is just a brief overview of from the beginning to where we are today. Over time, this role has expanded, become more critical as it related to healthcare delivery, research, regulation, and disaster relief itself. The first major event was in 1798. John Adams signed into law the Act for Relief of Sick and Disabled Seamen. This kind of triggered the creation of the marine hospitals along our major waterways. And from there, in the early 1800s, this expanded to more marine hospitals being established along port cities, such as Boston, New Orleans. And then by 1870, the Marine Hospital Service was created, centralizing these services under one administration, which is called the Supervising Surgeon, which today is known as the Surgeon General. By 1871, an individual named John Maynard Woolworth, the first Supervising General, adopted a military model for his medical staff at these marine hospitals. And he actually initiated this mobile uniform service to various hospitals to provide service to those that were sick and disabled. This kind of played a pivotal role in slowing and thwarting those diseases such as smallpox and yellow fever that were occurring in the states at that time. And then by 1889, Congress established the Public Health Service Commissioned Corps with the Marine Hospital Service. And by 1902, this broadened the reach of the Commissioned Corps into researching human diseases, sanitation, water supplies, and sewage disposal outside that normal medical care that was being provided. And then again, in the 1940s, the Commissioned Corps broadened their scope even more. Instead of just physicians, it was now open to engineers, dentists, nurses, other healthcare specialties. It kind of opened the floodgates, and this led to almost quadrupling in numbers of the Commissioned Corps, which leads us to today with over 6,000 active duty officers in 11 categories, all working for the same goal of preventing disease, sickness, and suffering throughout the world. So as you mentioned, there's 11 categories kind of serving on different deployment areas and different agency areas. This is the brief overview of things that you might see commissioned corps officers in. For example, disease control prevention, such as being an epidemiologist at CDC. You could also do research in NIH, National Institutes of Health. We have a lot of officers who work for the FDA as consumer safety officers, researchers. You're also able to work at the Bureau of Prisons or BOP in the mental health capacity. And then, like myself, environmental health officer. There are availabilities at the Indian Health Service, the EPA, even FDA has EHOs. And then you have these physicians, nurses who serve at international and domestic capacity during emergencies and normal pandemics such as today. So there are a range of places that Commissioned Corps officers do work at. I work at the Indian Health Service, which is across multiple states in the United States. We also have the National Institute of Health, FDA, as I mentioned. National Park Service does have Commissioned Corps officers, along with CDC, NOAA, EPA, USDA, and Department of Homeland Security. There are more programs than this represented. You can find more about that online at the USPHS.gov website. And I know this map's a little squished. This is just a general map of locations where Commissioned Corps officers are currently stationed. This is not all encompassing, but you can see that they are kind of spread all over the United States. And there are some international who work at agencies that do go abroad for their time period. So becoming a Commissioned Corps officer is a process. It's almost as if you are applying to the military. You must meet basic qualifications, such as being a US citizen. There is an age restraint of 44 years of age, and you must meet medical qualifications listed on the website. Depending on what your degree is and what category you're interested in applying to, there are qualifying degree restrictions. So usually it's an accreditation or some sort of credential you might need to meet that qualification. And if you do have a license, it must be current unrestricted, no suspensions or anything like that. And you would go on to the USPHS.gov website, and there's a walkthrough process for you. When I applied to Commissioned Corps, it took me from start to commissioning about 2 years. Sometimes it's faster for individuals, but it seems like the current time period is a couple of years when you're applying. Just keep that in mind. And then I'm just going to give a brief overview of the Indian Health Service, which is the agency I work for here in Utah. So the Indian Health Service is an agency of the Department of Health, Human and Health Services, just like Commissioned Corps. They are responsible for providing federal health services to American Indians and Alaska Natives. And this provision of health services is based on the federally recognized tribes. And this came out of a special government-to-government relationship based on Article 1, Section 8 of our Constitution in 1787. The Indian Health Service is a comprehensive health service delivery system. They employ individuals from all ranges of categories, federal employees and Commissioned Corps officers. And currently there is about just over 2 million American Indians, Alaska Natives being served by Indian Health Service. And there are currently 574 federally recognized tribes in 49 states being served by this agency. The mission of Indian Health Service is to raise the physical, mental, social, and spiritual health to the highest level. And they use this for a vision of imagining healthy communities and quality care systems through partnerships and culturally responsible practices, understanding their needs and how they can better provide for them. And then the goal is to ensure that these comprehensive cultural set of personal services are available and accessible. A lot of the tribes are located in areas that are pretty remote, especially in Alaska. It's hard to get them services. So the foundation of this is to make sure that they are provided what they need and they have the capacity to get it. Currently, the acting director of the Indian Health Service is Elizabeth Fowler, which you can see her photo on the right-hand side. And this is a breakdown of the different service areas. As I mentioned earlier, I'm located in Utah, so I fall under the Phoenix area, which covers Nevada, Arizona, and Utah. There is a large population in Alaska, but usually you'll see people spread out in the rural areas. I'm located in Fort Duchesne, which is about 3 hours from the nearest big city. So you're usually kind of spread out. You're not usually close to a major city based on where the tribes are located. And then I work in the Office of Environmental Health and Engineering as an environmental health officer. So OEHE has five breakdowns. So there's Department of Environmental Health Services, which is what I fall under. There's also Division of Sanitation Facilities Construction, Facilities Planning Construction, Facilities Operation and Engineering Services. This is where our engineers fall into. So you have the environmental health portion, and then you have engineering as a complement to them. So in the Phoenix area, we serve 53 tribes through 10 service units. I am one of those service units. Between all these service units, we have 65 EHOs and engineers working towards the same goal, with 3 district offices, 7 field offices, and within 4 states. We do cover part of California, the Owens Valley. So if you see the photo here, I'm over here in this yellow dot. This is the base reservation that I work at, covering the state of Utah. So we're kind of spread out all over the 3 states. So outside the Phoenix area, there is a breakdown of districts. So I reside in the Reno district. Just the Reno district itself serves 34 tribes within 3 service units. I am in what's called the UNO service unit. And that, between us, there's 12 EHOs and engineers, 1 district office, which is the Reno office, and then 2 field offices. So I'm one of those field offices, and then we have an ELCO service unit field office. And we cover the 3 primary states of Nevada, Utah, and part of the Owens Valley in California. The Public Health and Indian Health Service, and as I mentioned, I'm part of the Division of Environmental Health Services. So we have 2 primary functions that relate to public health. One is the actual Environmental Health Services. It's a pretty comprehensive and broad program. It's completely based on the tribe's needs and their contract with the IHS. So we do anything from hazard assessments, investigations, fire safety is a big portion of what we do, industrial hygiene, disaster preparedness, occupational safety, and food sanitation. Every day is not the same day. It's just really what's going on and what is needed. And then a supplement to that is our injury prevention services. So this is based on epidemiology and training, partnership with the communities we have here to ensure we have a foundation to reduce the risk of death and disability. A lot of the major foundations of this are the opioid awareness crisis. So getting out in communities and, you know, medication disposals, bringing awareness and education of, you know, Narcan, Naloxone. Also motor vehicle safety related car seats and seatbelt usage. The reservations have a high chance of having motor vehicle crashes and fatalities due to lack of seatbelts and car seats for children. And then we also have the portion of elder falls and then in-home services that work with the public health nurses. Another foundation is we follow the 10 essential public health services. These describe the public health activities that all communities should undertake. IHS is in the process of updating theirs to match the 2020 CDC 10 public health services. This is the essential public health framework. It was originally developed in 1994 and it's periodically updated to make sure that it's in line with current and future public health practice. So as you can see on here, a lot of this revolves around the community problems, identifying them, making sure education and empowering them is occurring, and then developing policies and community partnerships to strengthen the tribes to make sure that they are able to have these basic public health services available to them. And from the environmental health program portion of it, we cover a variety of areas depending on where you're located and the needs of the tribe. Here in Utah, I do a lot with emergency management, food safety, healthcare. We're getting into the healthy housing, which is the CDC foundations for homes, recreational water, vector, communicable disease control. It's a mixed bag of what's going on and what programs they are needed to be developed and implemented. But there's a broad opportunity to use your degree and skills to strengthen the tribal communities. And similar to applying to the Commissioned Corps, working at Indian Health Service, you must meet basic qualifications. They're looking for a certain kind of education and experience. There are a lot of jobs that are entry level. So there's a pathways program. We can come in right after college. Or if you have a master's, you can come in right after your master's. Some do require licenses. So if you come in as an environmentalist, the higher you get up, the more you would need your registered sanitarian to do sanitarian work. There's also the based on location selection. As I mentioned, a lot of the tribes are located in remote areas. It's a very fulfilling job. It's just a matter of understanding that you're going to be in probably a remote area. Some are more remote than others, but you're located near the tribes that need the services the most. And if you have any questions on applying to Indian Health Service, most of the postings have a hiring authority listed at the bottom on usajobs.gov. You can always reach out to the hiring authority with questions. They're happy to answer them. And it also doesn't hurt, like as was mentioned earlier, reaching out on LinkedIn to kind of get their takes on how the job is going and what you're doing on a daily basis. Everybody's kind of different what they're doing based on where they're located. But the foundations are a lot of the same for us. And then just some advice based on my experience in public health, working in the private and in the federal sector, is definitely an opportunity to be open to different career opportunities. I went through a variety of careers. I worked in healthcare, I worked in hospitals, I was a consultant, and I worked for the Indian Health Service doing kind of a mixture of both. It's exciting to be able to use everything that you've developed skill-wise and degree-wise, but just be open that sometimes the details of the posting may not match exactly what you're doing, but you do have the opportunity to use your skills in a variety of ways. It's also good to take classes and trainings that interest you in your career path. You're not going to really know what you like until you start putting yourself out there and trying things. This is the same with networking. If you see people on LinkedIn, they're doing a position that you think is something you want to do, you can reach out to commissioned corps officers, federal workers. There is limitations of what can be said, but they can give you kind of a guidance on, you know, what do they do? Like, how's their experience? Like, how do you get started? And the same thing, if you have an idea of what you think you want to do, research those positions, look at the requirements, especially on usajobs.gov. They pretty much spell it out for you. You'll do an assessment, but they'll list out, you know, degree requirements, your credentialing, time and grade, anything like that is going to be spelled out on there. And in that, make sure you're setting realistic career goals and you continually reassess your goals. Things change. Nobody's path in their career is linear. You're going to be going up and down. You might be switching around a lot. But as long as you have an idea of where you want to go and how you're going to get there, just be open to different things that come to you during your path there. And this kind of ties into understanding your limitations. Nobody knows everything when they're first starting out. You're going to have weaknesses in conjunction with your strengths. You don't understand what those are and learn from them and grow from them. And this is going to really help with starting and developing your career. We don't all get from point A to point B in the way we want, but if you're open and you work on yourself and you take those opportunities, it's a very good opportunity to expand your personal and professional growth. And this is my contact information. This is my work email and my office line. So if you have any questions, you can always feel free to reach out to me. Otherwise, that is all I currently have.
Thank you so much for talking about your career and the health service and the Indian Health Service. I'll open it up to questions. We had one in the chat, but you already hit on it, so that was good to go. So do we have any other questions right now?
Paula, that was great. This is Jane, thanks. So what kind of assignments do you have now? What are you working on?
So I'm currently in a mixed bag. I came into my position, it was vacant for a few years, so it's kind of starting from ground zero. COVID has greatly impacted what we can do with travel restrictions and, you know, quarantine. The American Indians have been hit very hard by COVID, so there's a lot of restrictions in place. Currently, some of the things I'm working on, not going into too much of detail in them, are emergency preparedness for health clinics related to their disaster response plans, trainings, how the communication. I'm doing environmental impact assessments for tribal lands where there are events going on or potentially housing issues to determine, you know, is there environmental impact and public health impact to those conditions of those facilities. And we are also getting a time of year where we are doing a lot of rabies vaccinations for local tribes. Out here, there is a large roaming dog population issue. So to address that public health impact, we do spay, neuter, and rabies clinics routine through the communities to try to get them in, get the dogs off the street and reservation.
So what's the incidence of rabies there, dog rabies?
It's not very high here. It's much higher in Arizona. But there's enough unvaccinated that we want to make sure we stop it before anything does occur. We got lucky the last couple of years here with low rabies or very low West Nile incident, mosquito-wise.
And so wildlife population, where the source in wildlife population is, what is it? What is it there for where you're at in the Reno area?
Nevada has a little bit more wildlife diversity than I have here. Most of what we have here is the elk, the deer, muskrat, things like that. The reservation I sit on is the second largest reservation in the United States. There's a lot of open land, so things are kind of clustered around. We don't see too much wildlife other than the animals that are strays and let go, for the most part.
I was thinking about the rabies reservoir, though. So is there, I guess, you know, Pennsylvania, I guess we think of a lot about raccoon rabies, for example. But is that the reservoir in the, where's the reservoir in the...
On what Utah State has indicated, it usually is the dogs. Based on the low case count there was in 2021, the incidents that did happen came from dogs, or I think there was a couple of raccoons closer to western Utah.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't have as many of the issues as the southern states do.
Interesting. I have more questions, but I don't want to hog the microphone here. So Jen or other people go on.
I figured you did. That's why I just paused, because you always like to take the, or you, not that you always like, but you always take the first one and it's always a good one. So, so talking about rabies and things like that, that's not something that I would have thought of immediately. So what's something that, about you, like your job and what you do now, that kind of surprised you and that you wouldn't have anticipated that you're doing that you wouldn't have anticipated doing?
It's a lot of generalized things. When I was a consultant, I specialized in areas. So when I did my audits, I was a waste specialist. I knew air regulations, permitting, like I specialized in those things. Here, it's kind of a mixed bag. The tribes report only to the EPA. So there's no like state requirements really they follow, but you really have to know a little bit of everything. Because you get calls about literally anything. You're the environmental person. They know you from being around. So they come to you with questions related to anything. So it's a matter of, is it something that I know, or do I know somebody that can answer this question for them? So out here, a lot of the things we get were with COVID, they were greatly impacted. So a lot of it had to do with preparedness, and then like food safety, because, you know, things were closed. So people are like making more food at home. So it's like, you know, how do you kind of adjust your train of thought more quickly based on what you're being asked.
All right, I'm still watching the chat. So if you've got a question, feel free to raise your hand, but Gene, go for it. You always have good questions, so I always like listening to you.
again, thanks, Paula. So what, can you talk to a little bit about the emergency preparedness that you're working with the tribes on? What does that look like? Or was there a model that you follow? What's important there?
So we go by type of facility and the regulations that we can cite for it. So everything has to have a backup to provide that guidance to them. So my facilities here, I don't have the same as every air tribe does. I vary from what Nevada has, but there was just a lack of basic business occupancy plans. So like in case of emergency, where do you go, doing your hazard vulnerability assessments? Those aren't things I usually thought of. Usually it's just a matter of I leave and that's where I'm gonna go. The tribe here, I'm lucky in that they have a very good emergency management team who's very highly trained, and they try to work on those community events where, you know, having your 72-hour kits, which are very big out here because we're in the middle of nowhere, something happens, it's not like you're gonna have the resources right away. And then fires out here, you know, the dry lightning. So work with them on doing trainings and community engagement, passing out information. We use a lot of FEMA resources and just kind of making sure their plans are up to date. And do they know the resources they have available to them? Is there mutual aid nearby that they can use? And are they fostering those partnerships? So we're kind of like a consultative role of, is it there? If it's not, how can we assist them to make sure it is there and it does work in before emergency occurs?
Do you do much in the way of drills or exercises then with them, with the NNL service?
The expectation is the tribal facilities do their own drills. They can request their services there. I have been requested to participate in the drills and kind of like survey them, make sure, you know, is the criticisms there they need to make sure it's improved. It's more, the healthcare facilities have a kind of a bigger requirement for that. So I am assisting with them with those, but it's pretty much on their own unless they request our services. And at that point, then we're kind of let in to see what they're doing and give them that guidance that they are requesting.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Interesting.
Yeah, it's a little bit different where I was used before this of, you know, I came in, did an assessment. Here's my recommendations. Here what you should do. I kind of check in of, did you do it or not? And what's the repercussions of not doing it? Here it's more of, I provide you the guidance upon request. And we'll work with them through it to make sure it's up to date. And then we kind of just, if they want us to partner with them and follow them, we do. Otherwise, we're just there as a resource when they need it.
Yeah, I guess that last statement is really important to remember. You're there as the Indian Health Service. Your role is, correct me if I'm wrong, but your role is more of an advisor consultant upon request, yep, as opposed to having responsibility. I mean, there's still the tribal management,
so if they, right?
Governance.
Yeah, so they have their sovereign authority. They can request our services. So most just the tribes we deal with, you know, we have a contract with. We're there as a resource. So they may not need our assistance all the time, but we are there. I'm lucky in the fact that I sit on a reservation, so I'm easily accessible. But we are consultative. So we don't go in and tell them what to do. They request services, we provide recommendations and guidance and work hand in hand with each other, essentially.
So back when I was with CDC back in the late 80s, early 90s, they were developing the sort of the Indian Health Service Epidemiology Hubs or something like that. I'm sure I've got the wrong title, but where they were hoping to draw together data that could be used for epidemiologic purposes across the entire Indian Health Service. Is that, are you familiar with that? Is that still happening?
I think it is occurring. We have that second function, which is our injury prevention program. I do know that we draw a lot of state statistics and also tribal statistics on things related to like the opioid crisis, motor vehicle fatalities, in some instances it's firearm safety. So they kind of draw those, that data together. Our coordinator for the Reno District did do a presentation at a conference recently about medication disposal. So they did a survey across multiple tribes and multiple states on medication management related to, morbidities, and kind of use it of how you better impact the community with disposal and ensuring that they understand what to do with their stuff afterwards. My understanding is they usually use that for that capacity. The environmental health portion, we don't draw a lot of data except for if we're looking for a very specific study requested by the tribe.
Okay. Interesting.
So just out of curiosity, when there's some, like using COVID as an example, when the state would report their case counts, would that include the number of cases that were on the reservation, or are those a completely different metric?
I can't speak for every state and every location. Here, it initially was the counties reported. Our reservation here spans two counties, so they were reporting the tribal numbers. The IHS also has only their numbers that the individuals that come to the IHS facilities get counted towards that. So there was kind of like a reconciliation of those numbers. Now it's IHS has their own numbers here since most of the reservations only going to the IHS facility. But they work very closely with the health department here. It's located just a couple of miles off the main road. So they're pretty good about collecting your data and sending it out to everybody.
So I know you had your slide that had a couple good recommendations for people. What's like, if there's one piece of advice that you wish that you knew like 10 years ago, what would it be?
Probably the point where I said, be open to other career paths. When I graduated from Penn State, I had a very specific idea in mind of what I wanted to do. And at least where I was located at the time, it was very hard to get into that field. I did not do my research to the extent that I should have in hindsight. I really should have done more outreach and networking and all of that. So I took a different job that was still emergency services, but not what I wanted to do. And that first job was a stepping stone for everything else, but I really enjoyed that job and I did not think I was going to. even though in my mind it was completely unrelated. And now, you know, going on 10 years later, I've used every skill from most of the jobs I've taken in one capacity or another now. And it made me a very well-rounded person now. But if you would ask me like 10 years ago, am I where I want to be? I probably would have said no. I kind of wasted some time there. But I can fully say now that it's kind of come full circle. And you really do use anything you pick up in the jobs. You'll retain that and you'll find something that kind of mixes them all together and it'll work.
So this is a question for you. And then I'm also going to ask Captain Dayton. I know he just came here to listen, but I'm going to put him on the hot spot too. What's your favorite thing about the public health service? Like if you were talking to somebody who is interested and they asked you, you know, what makes you want to get up in the morning and go to work? What is it?
I like the variety, as I mentioned, like it's just everything's different every day. I also like the fact that you are not committed to one agency or one path. You can literally, I can go from Indian Health Service to the CDC to anywhere else. I can just apply to the position and learn new skills and have different training and just kind of broaden my skill set while helping in the capacity that I would like to help the nation.
Thanks. All right, Captain, how about you?
Well, hey, great. Thank you for the opportunity. So hello, everyone. Just looking at my career, I've been in for a long time now, 20 plus years. And looking back, it's been a kind of a lots of different things have kind of kept me coming to work and but the probably the main theme is just doing that public health work that is satisfying, that has kind of a reward at the end. And so, you know, I look at it as I was in the Coast Guard, I did specific Coast Guard work, but when I found public health and response and industrial hygiene, health and safety, that was my niche. And I just kind of knew it at that point. And so that's when I transferred into the public health service and knew that was going to be something that I would wake up every morning and have the ambition, the drive, and the just literally excitement to come into work to do the job. And so that's something that was important to me. And so every day I go in, like Lieutenant Morgan was saying, it's there's something different. I've been in a COVID response mode for the last 2+ years. And even within that, it seems like every day is something different and a challenge in front of me. One of the other parts of that is having the trust of leadership. You're kind of in a consultation mode with leadership. So I've got everyone from, you know, 2-star admirals to captains to chief petty officers coming to me to ask the question, hey, is this okay? Or what's gonna happen if we do this? Those sorts of things are kind of those unsaid job satisfaction elements that again, give me the drive and the motivation. And so when you're trusted by folks and they know that you are there to help, that's a really, really big thing for me. And that's kind of always been a goal of mine too. So, so Jen, you made a mistake and let a No-6 talk. So there's always, they're going to go on much longer than they need to. So thank you though.
You're welcome. So for those of you who don't know, Captain Dayton is public health service. He works with me. Well, I ping him all the time from Coast Guard headquarters, asking him questions. He's a graduate of our program and did a webinar for us a few months ago, maybe even a year ago now. And it is on our site with the other recordings. So he talked a lot about what he does, but also how he used our degree to get to where he is. So just a little side note there. So does anybody have any more questions for Paula? I don't see any. So it is almost 9:00. So if nobody has any more questions, I won't keep anyone. But Paula, thank you so much for doing this. This is a great presentation. We really appreciate you bringing some awareness of the Public Health Service and the Indian Health Service to our students. We're going to post this for the students that couldn't be here tonight, but I appreciate you coming and speaking, sharing your contact information, and also, you know, not only doing that, but also coming back as a graduate of our program, staying involved and being willing to give up a Wednesday night. I know you have a lot of balls in the air, so thank you so much for doing this.
No problem. Thank you for having me. And if anybody ever thinks any questions, just let me know.
Thank you, Paula. It was great. Good. Have a good evening.
Bye, everybody. We'll see you next month.